welcome to episode number 194 of the SoxProspects.com podcast. We are the web's number one source for information on the Boston Red Sox farm system from top to bottom, from Fort Myers to Pawtucket, and all stops in between. Thank you for listening, everyone. My name is Chris Hatfield. I am the executive editor of SoxProspects.com, and I am joined, as always, by our director of scouting, Ian Kundle. Ian, we are officially in the offseason. The Los Angeles Dodgers, led by Corey Seager and Clayton Kershaw, and I don't know, who else do they have who's good? Urias pitched nice in the last game. I can't think of anyone else on that team who's any good. But anyway, the Dodgers are your World Series champions.
Yeah, I not
Brewster Graterol. They have Brewster Graterol. We actually have a Brewster Graterol question today.
I'm not that surprised they won, honestly. I feel like they were the heavy favorites coming into the year.
Yeah,
they're good. There were some really good games in that series. I really enjoyed the one that ended with the weirdness of the double errors and everything.
Yeah,
and my wife then did too. I really didn't enjoy the last game with some of the managerial decisions and then the decisions by some of the players after the game.
I'm with you on both counts. Yeah, just on the on-field piece of it, like I hate games decided by coaching decisions.
Yeah, that was tough one. It was. Yeah. I understand why the Rays, like, it's a very Rays thing to take him out. Like, it was not surprising to see it happen, but he was shoving. He had murdered the top of their lineup. They had Betts, who has not hit lefties at all this year. Like, mm-hmm. He's been ridiculously bad against lefties this year. And then Corey Seager was on deck, who can't hit, who's not as good against lefties either. And so you take out a guy who's, shoving to bring in a reliever who's given up runs in six straight appearances. Yeah. Like, I just hated that move in the moment. Like, I would have rather you live or die by Blake Snell. And if he gives up a home run to Mookie Betts, you know what? Good for that player.
Well, but, it's I think that's the piece that people are forgetting is the fact that he took him out to bring in Anderson.
Yeah,
who
like
had been
regular
bad.
Season. If it was regular season Nick Anderson, you have a better case. But Nick Anderson in the playoffs was literally atrocious. Like, I'm trying to bring up his numbers.
I mean, I've got Betts' splits. I mean, Betts against lefties this year was 200, 313, 218.
Exactly. He couldn't hit lefties this year, which is so weird.
And why would you bring in a righty to face Betts?
Well, it goes back, because I understand small sample size this year, but it actually carries over even into the end of his Red Sox career, where, like, after, I think it was, like, July or something, or June of 2019, he wasn't good against lefties either. Hmm. But yeah, Nick Anderson, like, regular season, 16 innings, 26 strikeouts, 0.49 whip, 0.55 ERA. Pretty good.
Yeah, he's good.
Playoffs, just not good. Like, he'd given up. His ERA was almost 6. He was striking out 9 guys in 14 innings, like 1.3 or 1.4 whip. Mm-hmm. Given up a run in 6 straight games, like, he wasn't the same pitcher, and I just hated bringing him in that situation.
Just have some feel. That's all. Yeah. I mean, it's like I get that you don't want to let the moment prevent you from making the correct decision.
Right.
And I admire the fact that Kevin Cash was willing. Cash certainly saw what we all were seeing, and I like that he was willing to step back and say, well, but here's the plan. But there are times when you need to recognize.
Yeah.
Like, this is why you have a manager.
Yeah.
Is that decision. Otherwise, they would just lay out the plan before the game.
Well, exactly. Right? And like, it's like Snell had given up. That was his second hit he'd allowed. He was at 73 pitches. Like, if he was even at 83 pitches or 93 pitches, I understand it more. But 73 pitches, yeah. Like.
Give him another inning.
Give him another. No, just give him.
Give him give until him, someone gets on second, at least.
Exactly. Like, don't just pull him immediately. Like, give him Betts, who hasn't hit lefties this year, who he struck out twice already in the game, and Corey Seager, who he struck out twice in the game, who is a lefty. Mm-hmm. Like, I just don't understand bringing in a righty in that situation. It was just, it made no sense to me.
Anyway, well, this is the Sox Prospects podcast, so let's talk about some Red Sox stuff.
Well, congratulations to Mookie Betts on the World Series championship.
Yeah, I was trying to avoid saying it, but yeah, congrats.
I'm fine saying it.
Yeah. Anyways, but we've got a lot to talk about. There's already a lot of 40-man roster machination and movement. We're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about the latest on the MLB situation. Mm-hmm. We've got a little bit of reporting on that today that we should talk about. Not going to have much of an update on Instructs, but we'll have a brief update on it. And of course, as always, your emails. We want to talk about what you want to hear about. So send your emails to us at podcast@soxprospects.com. You don't have to wait until we're recording an episode. We do put calls out for emails when we're going to record, but whenever you've got them, send them in, podcast@soxprospects.com, and we'll get to them on the next episode. And of course, if you want to support the podcast, you can support us on patreon.com/soxprospects. You donate a certain amount per episode, you pledge a certain amount per episode, and based on that, you get certain perks. And as always, we want to give a shout-out to our $5 level Patreon supporters. That's Kyle Costigan, Tyler Woodrow, Jeff Traynor, David Nardone, Tim Harding, Bill Stanton, Deb Kendall, Evan Kirkwood, Hurricanes 1, Chris Fox, James O'Hara, Nathan Kenyon, Andrew Wallen, Dave B., Ben Burnett, Al Mendel, Kevin Katrides, Ben and R.I., Paul Denyer, Lendl Martin, Cassandra Buchta, James P. McMahon, Stephen Gregory, and James Bailey. Thank you, everyone, for your support. Ian, let's start with what's already happened. The Red Sox have already cleared out 9 players from their 40-man roster.
Yeah, I mean, we saw this coming, but they're getting after it.
This is quick, yeah.
Yeah.
The Red Sox, when the season ended, had 40 guys on the 40-man roster. They had 7 players. No, hold on.
Six.
No, there's 6 now. Laire was also on the IL.
Oh, was he?
Yeah.
Okay.
So I want to say, actually, they might have gotten rid of him. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, counting Jackie Bradley. That's
no, Laire wasn't on the IL. I'm looking
yes,
at it right now.
He
was optioned to the alternate site on 9/18. Are you thinking of Zach Godley?
Maybe it was Godley. One guy was on the
Godley
IL.
Was on the 45-day IL at the end of the
it's
season.
It's Godley I'm thinking of. Thank you.
Okay,
appreciate
yeah.
it. Yeah, because I know like other guys were just on the regular IL. They were just basically throwing everyone on the IL at the end. But they had 47 guys. They've already removed 10. So they're down to 31 on the roster with 6 on the long-term IL that are going to be added back in the coming days. And we should probably just kind of briefly go over those. And then what we're going to do is we're going to go one by one through the 40-man and talk about, I guess, the likelihood they're going to stay in. Is that what you were thinking? Yeah. The likelihood they're going to stick around.
And what is their role next year? Because,
yeah.
like, as you said, they have to add those 6 guys back, and then they still have to add prospects for Rule 5, and they have to have room for additions. So there's still a lot of movement to be done.
Which is why I do think that there's going to be a fair amount of trading that happens that we can't really predict. But we'll see. We'll see. The first shot came on October the 23rd, and it was a little bit surprising to me and that this was the first move, but when the Seattle Mariners claimed right-hander Domingo Tapia off waivers.
Yeah, because we didn't even know he was on waivers. Like, there was none of the
B-writers said
anything.
You usually don't hear. I mean, today was a little bit of a different thing where, you know, players like Brad Hand being put on waivers was reported. You don't always hear about guys being put on outright waivers. Usually you hear about it when they clear or when they get claimed.
Yeah.
But Tapia being the first guy seemed weird.
I was a little surprised by that because I thought he was pretty good when he came up. Like,
he threw 100.
Yeah, but it wasn't just that. I mean, I understand velo is nice, but he struck out 4 guys in 4 innings. Like, his stuff was really good at the alternate site. He looks like he's got that power stuff you look for in, like, you know, a 6th inning reliever these days.
Yeah.
And so I just thought there were other guys that they had to clear. But, I mean, when you do the math, they have a lot of guys that they're going to have to move around. And they do have a lot of fungible righty relievers. So I guess maybe they were trying to maybe sneak him through early in the offseason.
That's my theory.
Was their idea. And obviously Seattle saw through that and claimed him. So
right.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, because the thing is, you can't teach 100.
No.
Right. You can't teach a guy 100. The issue with him is control.
Yep.
And I don't think he answered any of those questions. Like, someone was saying he was spotting 100, and I was like, no, he definitely wasn't.
We saw 4 innings. We don't know. But, I mean, he showed enough to me to get a chance in a major league bullpen next year.
No question. Yeah. But Tapia gone, claimed by Seattle. The rest of the players cleared outright waivers. The first round came on the 26th, and that was the Red Sox option. Outrighted Zue Lin, Robinson Laire, Mike Kickham, Zach Godley, and Andrew Triggs off the major league roster. And I guess maybe brief discourse on what outright waivers is. If a player is on the 40-man roster. To remove them, you have to place them on outright waivers. So the player is on waivers for a certain period of time. Every team has an opportunity to claim him. And if they claim him, he's added to that team's 40-man roster. And, you know, his contract, same contract, everything. Okay. So that's the outright waiver process. If a player has 5 years of service time, the player can refuse an outright assignment, basically forcing the team to release him. The reason a player would prefer to be released because they also have the option to opt for free agency rather than accept the outright assignment. There's a difference. It's subtle, but it's important. If, as a player, you refuse an outright assignment and the team releases you, you still get paid all the money on your contract. So, for example, if the Red Sox tomorrow release, I don't know, Chris Sale, they still pay Chris Sale his full contract. If you opt for free agency rather than the outright assignment, you are essentially voiding your contract. So you become a free agent, but you don't still get paid that money. So with 5 years service time, you get paid that money. With 3 years service time, or if you have already been outrighted once, but you do not yet have 5 years service time, then what you can do is you can elect free agency. You can't just decline the assignment, refuse the assignment, but you can elect to become a free agent, in which case what happens is you basically forego the rest of your contract and you become a free agent. You don't see that happen super often, but it can happen. You can also defer to the end of the year. So if you get outrighted in like June, you can elect to become a free agent in like now, October. So that's how outright waivers works. If you don't have 3 years of service time and you've never been outrighted before, it's not optioned. Optioning is different. If you've never been outrighted before and you have less than 3 years service time, the team can outright you to the minors once, basically for free. Getting back to the players. Mike Kickham, Zach Godley, Andrew Triggs, all elected free agency. Didn't matter because it's the end of the year and they didn't have any contract remaining, but they elected free agency. They're all free agents. Lynn and Lair were just outrighted at Pawtucket. First time being outrighted, not enough service time. The thing is, they both become minor league free agents anyway, 5 days after the World Series. So it's kind of a moot procedural point. They become minor league free agents because they've played at least parts of seven seasons in the minors. So they both become free agents after 5 days after the World Series. Next round came on the 28th, Ian, and that was Dylan Covey, Jose Peraza, Cesar Pueyo, all outrighted off the roster. Peraza and Pueyo elected free agency. Covey did not. He couldn't. But I believe he also becomes a minor league free agent. I'm not completely sure, but I'm fairly sure. So that's the status of those players. Peraza, Pueyo, Kickham, Godley, Triggs, free agents. Lynn, Lair, Covey will become free agents. And in addition, of course, the day after the World Series, Jackie Bradley, Rusney Castillo, and Colin McHugh were all declared free agents. Bradley obviously being the big one there. But Rusney Castillo, Ian, probably worth a brief mention, the end of an era for the Pawtucket, soon-to-be Worcester Red Sox.
Mm-hmm. Secure the bag. Good for Rusney. He got paid.
He did get paid. He did get paid.
I feel bad for him. Like, he was talented enough to play in the big leagues in some capacity. He just unfortunately got caught in a roster situation where the Red Sox financially, it made no sense to add him back to their roster no matter how good he was, basically.
Right.
Because if they added him back, his salary counted towards the luxury tax. And yeah, it was just kind of a situation. It was a little bit of a loophole. I mean, there's a reason you can't do what they did with him anymore. And yeah.
Well, yes and no. I mean, Castillo still got his money.
No, I'm saying it's unfortunate, though, because I would have been interested to see what he could do against major league pitching back like 2-3 years ago. Not necessarily like in 2019, but like, you know, looking at 2017, 2018, him would have been interesting.
Yeah, I mean, but I mean, here's the thing with Castillo that people are that people do forget. I'm not saying that you have. I'm just saying context for people listening. Is Castillo did get a pretty good shot in 2015. He played 80 games in the majors, and he hit 253, 288, 359 at age 27. Like, it's not like he was a 20-year-old and over his head. He did get some run before he got outrighted. You know, the rule that if you outright a guy, his money still counts toward the CBT, I think is garbage, frankly. It's just designed to keep salaries down. That's why that rule is there.
Yeah, but like we're gonna see like well, there's gonna be. Later, I mean, there's that's not, owners that's do that. Not surprising.
Yeah, well, the owners. That's what. Then that's my point. That's exactly my point. Is like you could outright the guy off the roster, but it's like the rule you've passed has made it such that players can't come back up. Not that necessarily they're gonna not sign contracts. I don't know. It's just if a guy stinks and he should go down to the minors, like. Why should he still count toward the major league CBT? Like that just doesn't make sense. Like when he cleared waivers, like every major league team had a shot at him. It's not like you could just option a guy and he doesn't count, right? Like he has to clear waivers to not count. I don't know. It seemed to make sense to me before. I didn't like the change when it happened. It screwed Castillo over a little bit. But that said, I'll also kind of talk about the other side of this. Castillo wasn't like. Like, look, in 2017 was probably his best season in AAA. He hit 314, 350, 507. That translates to a pretty good player in the majors, and I would have liked to have seen that, but it's not like he would have come up and been an all-star. He was like a borderline regular maybe. I mean, it was 2 years after after he stunk. Like,
no, I agree. I don't know. I just would have been interested to see what he could do at that point in his career.
Yeah, because now, I mean, I was looking back. It's just, you know. He's not the same player. Like in Pawtucket last year, or not last year, 2 years ago, he only slugged 448 when they were using an Incrediball. Like, you know, the previous year, he only slugged 416. Like, he's not the same player. No,
he's lost athleticism. He can't play center field anymore. Like,
right, right.
Yeah.
So we'll see what happens with him. My guess is he signs a minor league deal with a non-roster invite somewhere, Ian.
I would assume so.
Yeah. I won't be in Boston, I'll tell you that much. I think both player and team are ready for that divorce, frankly. So, happy trails, Rusney Castillo. We have a question about Jackie Bradley in the email, so we're not going to talk about that. But that's what's happened so far, Ian. I mean, none of the moves so far have really... No one's been outrighted that surprised me, I'll put it that way. I'm like the order is interesting. Like I think there are guys still on the roster and we'll get to that like I'm kind of surprised haven't gone along with them. But no one that's been outrighted really surprised. Like people were decrying Tapia getting outrighted and I'm like, look, they had seven guys on the 45-day IL.
Yeah.
They've got to add another six to protect them from rule five. That's
at least
13.
Six, yeah.
At least six. That's 13 guys.
Well, it's not 12 because Godley was one of them.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's 13 of the... So you basically had 47 and 6 is 53 players for 40 roster spots.
Yeah.
You were going to have to get rid of 13 of those players.
Yeah.
Getting rid of the 13 players on the 40-man roster, like, yeah, these guys are all in the 13 that I would have probably picked. So,
yeah, I agree. Yeah, there's a few, like, minor surprises, but, I mean, it's all, like, we're splitting hairs here when you get that deep on the 40-man.
Yeah. Yeah, and I mean, then never mind the fact that you still need a center fielder, you still need a second baseman, probably, you still need relievers, you still need at least one, if not two starters.
Yeah, they need a lot of stuff.
They need a lot of stuff. So there's probably going to be 16 at least players that were on the 40-man roster at the end of the year that aren't
on the roster. Yeah, I was going to say, I would expect five to eight more guys are going to have to get cleared.
Well, do we want to go into that now, Ian? I mean,
Yeah, I think it's a good transition.
Okay, so let's go into the 40-man roster. So let's go. I've got our sites 40-man up, Ian.
I do too.
Okay, so the way that ours is set up is basically it's, you know, guys just kind of matriculate up the list as they've been on the 40-man. So at the top is Dustin Pedroia, who has obviously the most tenure on the 40-man by a wide margin.
Should we do that discussion now?
I mean, yeah, we kind of have to if this is how we're doing it, right? But it's like he was added in August 2006. For reference, the next longest tenured player on the 40-man is Christian Vazquez, who was added in November of 2012, more than six years later. So Dustin Pedroia, Ian.
Oh, I think
it's been updated for the 2021 season. Dustin Pedroia.
I think you have to approach him and say, I'm sorry, but we're going to have to release you. I don't see how you can justify keeping him on the 40-man this offseason. When you need the spots, you want to be active. We know Chaim Bloom loves being active in waiver claims. There's going to be a ton of non-tenders. I don't see how you can burn his 40-man spot all the way to spring training when you can put him back on the 60-day again. I just don't see how that makes sense for a roster building perspective.
Unless here's the one way I could see it. Because the thing is, his money's going to count towards the CBT anyway.
Yeah.
Unless he were to retire, which he shouldn't.
No.
He's earned that money. If you plan on signing someone who you intend to have on the opening day roster and you're going to sign them to a minor league contract with a non-roster invite, saying, look, for PR reasons, we don't want to release Dustin Pedroia. So the second he goes on the 60, you're going to get his roster spot.
I mean, I guess, but like he hasn't played since 2017, really. Like at some point you just gotta I don't think it'll be that bad PR, would it, if they just released him?
Well, what to be clear, he has played since 2017, just not.
No, I know, but
not a lot.
He's played like five games a year.
Right. I think what it is you do the David Wright deal where you say, you come to an agreement like, look, Dustin, you're done. It's clearly not happening. We can't carry you. What we would like to do is offer you a job in the front office where you're going to make the same amount of money. You'll actually earn your salary, right? But we'll release you and you'll retire after being released. Or maybe you won't retire, right? But you'll still get paid, whatever.
Yeah, I think they'd like to keep him in the organization, but I just don't think it makes sense to keep him on the 40 unless you're doing what you said. But even then, I'd still probably rather have the spot.
Yeah, I mean, look, the Boston Red Sox have always been a very PR conscious organization. And are they going to be afraid to pull the trigger on releasing Dustin Pedroia? I don't know. It's insane to hold on to. I mean, you look at kind of like Wright's an example, Prince Fielder's an example. At some point, you just have to say, like, look, you're not coming back. We have finite spaces. We're releasing at least 15 guys this year, this offseason. Why are we holding on to you when you're not going to play? But yeah, I mean, it's tough love on Pedroia, Ian, but I think it's what you have to do. You can't carry that player if he's not going to play when you're in an offseason where you're releasing 15 guys, outrighting 15 guys early in the offseason. So I think you have to have that conversation. I think you just have to do it. Next up, Ian, on the 40-man is Christian Vazquez. Probably no reason to belabor the point. I have no reason to think he's not the starting catcher next year.
Yeah, I mean, the only way he's not on the roster is if they get a big trade offer for him. And it's pretty clear at the deadline they had a very high price for him. Yep. And if someone wouldn't meet it at the deadline, I doubt someone's going to meet in the offseason. So he'll likely be the starting catcher next year, barring some unforeseen trade.
For $6.25 million with a $7 million team option?
Yeah. Club option.
Club option. Yep. $7 million club option for 2022 that I, at this point, would presume they'll pick up.
Yeah, it's a very reasonable salary for a starting catcher. Like, yep. Vazquez isn't an elite starting catcher, but, you know, he's a top, like, borderline top 10 starting catcher in baseball, so he's good.
Xander Bogaerts, obviously, is sticking around. He's the starting shortstop. Has an opt-out for after 2022, Ian.
Yeah.
Is there any way that he does not exercise that opt-out for $20 million? His contract is $20 million.
If the 2021 season gets canceled because of COVID, I don't know. Probably not. No, he's a Scott Boras guy. There's no way he doesn't opt out.
Unless he has some kind of catastrophic injury or something, right?
Yeah, like, I mean, it's like barring something unforeseen, he's opting out, and you're going to have to pay him like $25+ million a year. The problem is, though, I will say the 2020, is it after this year or is it after 2022?
It's after 2022.
The shortstop class is insane. So he's going to have a lot of comp. It's like him, Lindor, Correa, Baez, Seager. Like, it's a lot of people.
Which also means that all of those teams need shortstops.
Exactly.
Or most of them, at least. I mean, I guess the Dodgers, maybe you slide over Lux, but.
Yeah. I mean, he can't throw from second base, so I don't think you're sliding him to shortstop.
That's, yeah, true. Okay, fair enough. Yeah, that's a conversation for another time. Matt Barnes entering his last year of arbitration. No reason to think he gets non-tendered, Ian. I think he's...
No, I think they'll keep him around. And
the projection was between $3.7 and $5.7 million.
Yeah, that's reasonable. Yeah, maybe they, I don't know if I don't even think you could trade him anymore. I don't think there's a lot of value there to be had if you traded him like in the offseason with 1 year remaining. So I think, yeah, he's probably he goes into next year as the closer, or maybe they go sign someone, but he'll be a late inning guy for the Red Sox next year.
Well, I mean, maybe that's a quick transition if we want to go on a quick tangent, Ian. The Indians apparently today put Brad Hand on outright waivers.
Yeah.
If you're the Red Sox, do you claim him? 1 year, $10 million club option.
I would personally, because I understand last year, like, his stuff was down a little bit and he had some shaky outings. But at the end of the day, like, his overall season stats, he had a 2.05 ERA, 1.37 FIP. Strikeout rate was 11.86 per nine, or not strikeout rate, but his K per nine was 11.86. Walk per nine was 1.64. Like, he was very good last year. And for $10 million a year on a 1 year deal, like, the guys who are out there looking at the closer options, it's like Liam Hendricks, guys like Roberto Osuna also got placed on waivers today, but he's going to be coming back from injury. There's not a lot of high-end relievers. And if you can get Brad Hand on a one-year deal and not have to give up anything, I don't see why you wouldn't, unless – and if he doesn't get claimed, I think this signals that the spending around baseball this year is going to be very, very little. Because if he can't get 10 – if no one is claiming a one-year $10 million on a what would have been an all-star reliever – for nothing, then there's big issues.
And the key thing is the 1 year for me, for a reliever. Yeah. If I can get a reliever for 1 year.
Well, that's the thing. It's like, worst case, you claim him, then trade him at the deadline if you're bad again this year. Like, because like Liam Hendricks is the best closer available, and he's going to, like, would you rather have Brad Hand at 1 year 10 or Liam Hendricks for 3 years at 30? Like, I'm giving a 1 year deal every day of the week.
I don't even think, say the market is just completely collapsed and Hendricks gets
24
7 yeah 3.7 a year,
21 24 yeah I'd still rather
21 10. I would still rather 110.
Oh, speaking of contracts and stuff, a good point. The Yankees just extended Zach Britton for 2 years at $27 million. I would gladly take Brad Hand at 1 year at $10 million.
Right,
that literally just happened, but yeah, that's interesting to me. So I personally, and this is an important thing, the Red Sox have, because they were so bad last year, have the fourth highest priority on waiver claims.
Yep.
So, and the teams ahead of them, let's be honest, they're not claiming Brad Hand.
Pirates, Tigers.
And Rangers.
Rangers, yeah.
None of them are claiming him. So if he's if the Red Sox want him, they can probably have him. So it'll be interesting to see what happens with that.
Next up, Eduardo Rodriguez, last year of arbitration, Ian. That's an interesting situation.
Mm-hmm.
I was advocating strongly last year for the Red Sox to extend him. I mean, maybe you try and do like a short extension.
That's what I would try to do. Cause I mean, he's one of the guys who's on the IL who's obviously going to be added back.
Yeah.
And I would try to see if he would take like a 2 year, like, I don't know, $12 million, $15, $20 million, something in that range. I don't know exactly what his R figure is. What was his R figure for this year?
His projected arbitration range is 8.3.
Okay, so
2.3 under all three systems.
215, 218.
I should mention arbitration projections coming off of MLB trade rumors.
I think it makes sense. It would be a goodwill gesture from the Red Sox saying, like, we have faith in you, come back healthy. And I think it would also give him some security, which would be nice. Because, you know.
Heart problem,
He was excellent last year, but at the end of the day, it's an unknown what he's going to be when he comes back. And so if I'm him, I wonder who would approach first. Would it be him approaching the Red Sox or the other way around? Because I feel like it would be in both sides' best interest to work out some deal, like a short-term 2 or 3 year extension.
And that's why I could see them doing that. Yeah. It is in both of their interests. And the thing with, you know, with Rodriguez is, it's like, you know, there's a lot of risk there for him, not only because of the heart issue, but he didn't pitch for a year.
Yeah.
Like, what is his innings limit next year?
That's the thing. It's you
a
can't
year
come
after,
back and expect him to throw 200 innings. Like,
a year after Cora rode him into the ground. So maybe it's not the worst thing in the world that he got a year off, but like.
I think it was bad that he got the year off.
You know, I mean, I think it's bad too, but it's like, I mean, at least he recovers from 2019, but still, like.
Yeah. I don't know.
Can you throw him for more than 100, 120 innings next year without it being malpractice? Like.
Probably not. I mean, because if you look at his, like, it's not like he's one of these guys who's thrown 200 innings for five straight years either. Like, he was 121, 107, 137, 129, 203, not including the playoffs. Mm-hmm. So he's not exactly had like a huge workload other than 2019. So, yeah.
Yeah. So that's E-Rod. Next up, Andrew Benintendi. We've talked about it. I think he stays around because selling low would be kind of crazy.
Yeah, I don't think he has trade value, so I kind of think you have to bring him back. I will say one thing I've seen is some people are saying, like, do you go after Marcel Ozuna or a corner outfielder and move Benintendi to center field?
No.
Benintendi's not a center fielder.
No.
Like, the drop-off from Jackie Bradley to Andrew Benintendi in center field would make Red Sox fans tear their hair out because Benintendi's not a good left fielder. Like, he has, like, a 30 arm. He can't play center field. So if they're getting an outfielder, it would have to be a center fielder or right fielder because Verdugo could probably play center. Mm-hmm. But I would not count on Benintendi being the opening day center fielder. I know that has been suggested to some places.
Absolutely not. Yeah, no question. He's got 2 years left this year. His salary is set. Because
he's also not someone I would be looking to extend, obviously.
No.
Like,
Prove it. Chris Sale will be back when he's back. I mean, there's no reason to belabor that. Rafi Devers enters his first year of arbitration. His projected arbitration salary on MLB trade rumors is somewhere between 3.4 and 6.3 million.
I was going to say 4.5 was my guess. Yeah.
Yeah. So
I would try to extend Devers.
I would love to extend Devers.
Like, I would see if he would take like that Moncada extension, which was 5 years, 80 million, I think. Mm-hmm. I believe it was. Because obviously you'd be paying more next year, but you'd get some years on the back end. And I just think it's in the Red Sox best interest, given what has happened with some of their other players when they've approached free agency, that they try to extend him now.
5 years, 70.
5 years, 70. Exactly. Like, I would offer him that exact deal and see what he says.
Yeah.
Cause like, you'd buy out 2 free agent years, but he would get a huge raise in ARB for the first 2 years. Cause if he's going to make, like, let's say $5 million this year, that deal would give him like $12 million, $13 million this year. So I think
he gets it evenly, right?
Like, no, I know, but like the AAV I'm saying though, like,
yeah,
it would be a significant raise in the first couple of years is my point.
Right. No, that makes, I mean, that's, yeah, I would try that. I mean, I'm not worried too much about, you know, like the conditioning thing or like,
no, I just think it's a weird year.
I think look, the COVID quarantine thing was different for everybody.
And he obviously had some trouble like in the break, like getting to workout facilities and being able to stay in shape and came back overweight and it showed on the field. But at the end of the day, he's still a very good player.
JD Martinez, 2 more years left on his deal. He's got another opt out. He's not going to opt out this year. I think we can all agree.
There's no chance he opts out.
I don't think he opts out next year either.
I don't think he can opt out. He can opt out after next year. Yeah. No, I don't think so either.
Unless the NL adds the DH.
But even then, he was awful this year.
Well, like, he has to hit better.
Yeah.
He has to hit better. Assuming he gets better, I just find it tough. I think he's around for those 2 years, and I'm fine with it.
Yeah,
right, now we get into the interesting ones, Ian.
Mm-hmm.
Marcus Walden.
Like, it's crazy, first off, that he's one of the top 10 longest tenured Red Sox. Like, it just shows how much turnover there's been over the last, you know, 2 years.
It's nuts, right?
He's
actually, I think, 11. No, he's number 10. Yeah.
Yeah. I think
no, he's 11. He's 11th.
I would think he's on the chopping block if in the next round of cuts. But he was good last year, or 2 years ago. He just wasn't good last year at all. He's 33, or he's 32. He's about to be 33. Or no, he just turned 32, sorry. I personally would think he's one of the ones who we could see in that next round when they have to, you know, get other players back. Or if they go out of free agency, he's someone that could be gone.
Yeah, I mean, his value lies in the fact that I believe he's got one more option remaining. So I could see him maybe outlasting some of the other guys because he's got an option, but
fair.
I don't know. Let's see what happens with the rest of this list as we kind of maybe pick up the pace. Ryan Brasier, I don't think he goes anywhere.
No, I think he's back in the bullpen. He was good at the end of the year last year anyway.
He was.
So, yeah.
Yeah, he also has an option remaining, too, in case he is bad.
I don't see any way he – or barring a trade, he's probably back next year.
Nathan Eovaldi, I think, is back, and I think people think he's more movable than he is.
I don't think he's movable at all.
Yeah.
I don't think anyone's going to take on $17 million for a non-elite guy in a trade anymore, like, or at least this offseason.
Yeah.
Like, I think his contract makes him unmovable because, I mean, we're seeing, like, teams like the Indians have said they're going to slash like $40 to $50 million. The Cardinals did the same thing, have said the same thing. They cut Colton Wong, who had a very reasonable option. Like, it's not going to be good for market for free agents. And I just don't think he has a lot of trade value because of that.
I agree. Another interesting one in Colton Brewer. Brewer, of course, this year was not particularly great. 5.61 ERA, 1.75 whip. 25 Ks and 25 and two-thirds is good, but 14 walks isn't. He has one option remaining, I believe. I think he's kind of in that Walden group.
I agree. I think he's in that next tier of guys who could get like get cut. Or not cut, but like, you know.
Outrighted, yeah. Michael Chavis. Another guy who I think people think has more trade value than he does. Does that sound right?
Yeah, I don't think he has much trade value at all.
Yeah.
Like, he's not been good since the first month of his call-up.
Yeah.
Actually, he's been bad. He's been, like, he's, in terms of, I think he's negative war since the first month of his call-up.
Yeah, I think that's fair. I mean, I think you got to let him try and play it out, but I just don't know what the role is.
I don't know what you do with him, because he's just such a weird fit on a roster, because he's not, he's negative war because he's not good defensively anywhere. And if he's not hitting for power, then he's not like, what is he like?
Yeah.
This year, you know, his strikeout rate was still 32%. Walk rate was down from 8% to 5%. He hit 212 because his BABIP regressed back to closer. What it was like, it was a little low, but it regressed closer to what you'd expect. I don't know what you do with him next year. Like, is there any way he starts in the minors next year?
I mean, he does have
he has two options, right? Or two options.
So I think he starts. You start with him in pencil to be on the major league team, but, and I think we've talked about this before, Ian. But if you were to project a roster for next year, you could see in one conception of it a bench that includes Yairo Munoz, Michael Chavis, and Christian Arroyo, right?
Yeah,
the problem is they all hit righty.
Yeah, exactly. That's how you said it, but yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Like, that's the problem, and an all right-handed bench just doesn't help you.
Well, also because Kevin Plawecki's your catcher, and he's a righty too. So
right. So I just think, I mean, they're going to have to acquire a left-handed hitting bench player of some kind.
They need a left-handed hitting guy who can play first base and second base.
Right. Or I mean, that'd be ideal.
Yeah, but he's a weird fit on the roster.
Yeah.
I wonder if it's going to come down to, like, it's a either or with him and Arroyo. I just don't see, like, how both of them make sense on the roster.
They're redundant.
Exactly. And we haven't even discussed the fact that I don't think you want to go into year with Yairo Munoz as your backup shortstop either.
Yeah. And I mean, look, you know, right now you've got Bobby Dalbec penciled in as the starting first baseman. Do you want a platoon partner with him? Do you want a veteran backup? His Alex Cora? Like, what do you want on that roster? Can you achieve that with Chavis on the roster? You know, because, like, platooning Chavis and Dalbec doesn't make sense. They hit from the same side of the plate.
No. And, I mean, we saw last year Chavis was basically playing left field by the end of the year.
Right. Well, not like, basically. He was. He was only doing that because Munoz got hurt.
Exactly. So it's just, it's going to be interesting to see what happens because the roster just doesn't make sense as currently constituted or with all these guys. They're very similar. Like, they're different players, but like they fit the same, they need to fit the same role. So you have a bunch of like square pegs and round holes. You know, you don't have your backup defensive middle infielder. You don't have your left-handed hitter. You don't have a speed guy. Like, it's just a very weird bench is currently constructed, especially as I think one thing we have to remember is next year it's going to go back to a 26-man roster, it seems. So you're going to be operating with two fewer players than you were basically all of this season. So you're going to have bench guys who can play more roles. And
as we saw, like Zhu Weilin, who was the backup shortstop, or Jonathan Arauz, who also played some shortstop. Those guys are gone. Like, the bench as it is right now, even though there are four guys we have penciled in there, I just can't see any way this is what it looks like next year.
No, I'm with you. Moving along, Josh Taylor, I think he's up in the bullpen. That's a pretty simple one. Darwinzon Hernandez has some role in the major league bullpen.
Don't make him a starter, please. Just let him be a reliever.
Yeah. Ryan Weber. Different pitcher at the end of the year than he was at the beginning.
I know.
I think he's ahead of the Walden Brewer group.
In terms of getting off or staying on.
Like staying on. Like I think he's got a better grip on a job than those two.
I agree, because he can start too.
CJ Chatham.
I think he's gone. He wasn't good at the alternate site.
Nope.
Let's be honest. And he was never called up, even though they had a
need.
They
had him up on the taxi squad for like a week and a half.
But he was never up. Like, they called up Cesar Cuello instead of him at the end of the season.
No, they called up Arroyo instead. Well, yeah, but they basically called up Arroyo to take the job that we assumed that Chatham was going to come up for.
I think he's someone who they look to trade, but I don't think he has much trade value. He just hasn't shown, like, he's in a weird position because it's similar to the guys we were just talking about. He's a right guy. He can at least play shortstop, where he's like, he's fine. You know, he's an solid average shortstop, but he's not fast. He has no power. And I mean, he'll hit for an empty average, but he just doesn't hit the ball hard. There's no punch. Like, it's like an up and down profile. Maybe it's like an end of the bench player, but I just don't see. I feel like you can find, like, Yairo Munoz is a better version of what he projects as.
Right. Except that Chatham could probably pick it better, but still.
Yeah, but like Munoz at least can hit a little bit. Right. Like, I just don't think CJ Chatham can hit major league pitching. And he's sneaky, like, old. Like, Munoz and him are the same age, basically.
Right. Yeah.
Like, he's already 26, I think.
He is 25. He turns 26 in December.
Yeah, and Munoz turned 25 in January. So Munoz is like, okay, he's like a year older. But I just, yeah, I don't know what Chatham's role is. I just, at some point, I think they have to make the decision. Is his spot on the 40-man, you know, is it worth bringing him to camp next year to see if something changes over the offseason? Or do you have to just, you know, is there a better use for that spot?
Walden Brewer, I think, go first.
I agree. I mean, he's after several of pitchers and other players that we'll get to lower down on the list, but I don't think he's in the safe spot for me yet.
Yep. Chatham versus Weber. They're probably on the same-ish.
I think they're in the same tier.
Yeah. I think that sounds right. Kyle Hart.
Well, you skipped over Dahlbeck.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I mean, it's just not, there's not a lot to talk about there. Dahlbeck is on the major league roster. He is getting the lion's share of first base at bats.
I agree.
Kyle Hart is a very interesting case, Ian.
I think he's in the first group to go.
I do too.
Nice story. I think he will clear also. And he's not a minor league free agent, right? So he would stick around, or is he?
Let me look.
I don't think he is.
Oh my god, this website.
Oh, it's not on there because he's on the major league roster now.
Well, but I could tell you because it's if he played 7 years in the minors, and it's not because he was drafted in 2016. So it's 16,
no.
17, 18. 19,
I think
20,
he gets outrighted and he will stay in the system because I don't think he gets claimed.
Yeah, I mean, and he's also Rule 5 eligible. I wouldn't protect him from Rule 5.
No.
He could get picked. I could see a team taking him, but I don't think it'll happen. I don't think it'll happen. I agree with you, but it, like, weirder has happened.
Yeah, I just
but
think
just,
there's
it's not
use.
Great stuff. It's
yeah, I just think there's better uses of that roster spot.
Marcus Wilson, I think he's safe, Ian.
Mm-hmm.
Yoan Aybar, which I know we've let me see. We actually got an email about him. Maybe I'll bring that in.
Oh, here it is. The question is from Hash Brown Door.
Okay.
And his question is, what's the deal with Aybar? He wasn't at the alternate site, but is still on the 40-man. Will he stay on the 40-man this offseason?
He also asked a question about Marcus Wilson. Also, did the Red Sox see a future with Marcus Wilson, or is he a potential taxi squad guy because of a lack of outfield options in the org? So with Wilson, I think we can just quickly touch on. I still think they like him. They think he has some upside. It was just a weird year. He kind of got caught in a numbers game because he wasn't going to play a role in the big league roster this year, and they had other guys that they wanted higher to put priority on the thing who were higher priority. Like, yeah.
Grumada. Downs.
But then also with the outfielders, you wanted guys like Cesar Puello Munoz, who had a chance of making their major league debut, versus him.
Right. And I think, you know, look, he's not the top prospect in the system by any means, but that doesn't mean they're going to just jettison him.
Exactly.
You know, like, we'll get the question, like, is he in the plans, or are they going to trade him? It's like, well, that's not the dichotomy.
Yeah. It's also hard to say after a year where he had like a week of at bats at the alternate site. Right. Like, we'll find out.
Right.
With Aybar.
That's my gut, Ian, is to say no. He, of course, is going to stick around. It's a lefty that's up in the high 90s at times, but
I could see them trying to sneak him through.
Yeah.
I mean, the thing is, like, he's going to be pitching in the Winter League, I assume, in the Dominican Winter League. I would have to imagine, right?
This is Aybar? Probably, yes.
I'm pretty sure he was drafted out of the...
But
he was drafted in the Dominican Winter League draft at some point.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he has never played over there, but he is he's from the Dominican. So
I think you have to keep him around, but yeah, it's a tough one because this lost year for someone like him was brutal because he got caught out in the numbers with instructs because there's no way he was making his major league debut, and it made sense to have more starting pitching guys there. So the Grooms, Mottas, et cetera, got priority. And then he can't go to instructs because of the MLBPA rules, because he's on the 40 man.
Right.
And so he just kind of got caught in no man's land this year. So that was why I would wonder if they would try to sneak him through, is no one's seen him in a year. Like,
yeah. Yeah, I could see it. I think he gets picked up, though, because, again, it's.
Someone would claim him.
Upper 90s from the left side.
Yeah.
So I'm skeptical. I don't know what to do with that one.
Sticks around.
Yep. Jonathan Aruz, pretty cut and dry.
Yeah, I suspect he'll be the starter.
Double A or Triple A.
Triple A or Double A shortstop next year. Yeah.
Martin, good pickup by the Sox. Perez, club option for $6.85 million. If you had asked me about him a month and a half ago, I say they're definitely going to pick up that option. In this market, not so sure, my friend. What do you think?
I don't see it. The more I was on the same page as you, you know, we were talking about how it's great to have him locked in a couple pot, like, you know, over the summer. This is a great contract because he was pitching well. He leveled off at the end of the year and kind of turned in, put in the season you'd expect. And I think it was one of those things where the Red Sox rotation was so bad that it was nice having a professional pitcher come out every fifth day. And he was obviously a professional pitcher. And it kind of made me think he was better than he was last year. Because if you look at his overall numbers, he was fine. Like, he was a solid, like, number five starter. But, you know, it's like a six strikeout or a 6K per nine, like 4 walks per nine, ERA 4.5. You know, he's fine, but it's not anything to write home. And as we're seeing, teams are just not. The guys in that mid-tier free agency-wise, I think are just going to get decimated in this offseason. And I personally just don't think him at $7 million is good value, or six, almost $7 million is as good value as it looked pre-COVID. I mean, as we talked about, Brad Hand at $10 million got declined, and Brad Hand is significantly better than Martin Perez. Different positions, obviously. Colton Wong got declined. Like, there's going to be a lot of non-tenders and a lot of guys available that we don't expect, I think, to fill rotation spots. And I think you have a better chance of going out and getting those guys, or frankly, even bringing back Perez on like a 1 year, $3 million deal, like things like that. I think he's just going to have a tough time getting that type of money in the open market. So I think he probably doesn't get his option picked up.
Yeah. I think that's the thing, is it doesn't preclude him from coming back. If you really liked it here, okay, great. Come back. We're just not giving you 6.8.
Exactly.
Like, yeah. Chris Mazza, Ian.
He was actually decent at the end of last year.
He was pretty good. I think he sticks around. I think he's kind of in the...
I think he's in the Weber tier. I think he's ahead of, like, the Walden guys. But, yeah. Who knows? He's definitely not safe. But
Right.
I don't think he's the first one to go.
Kevin Plawecki, I saw his name as like a potential non-tender. Like,
I don't think there's any way they non-tender him.
Yeah,
he was excellent last year.
Plawecki is set to make between 1.3 and 2.0 on
per. Less than I thought. Yeah.
I mean, that's that. You, I think you're nuts to non-tender him.
Yeah, I don't think there's any way he's not the backup catcher next year unless something crazy happens.
Austin Brice enters his first year of arbitration. He's set to make between 700 and 900K. I think he's somewhere in between the Weber tier and the Walden tier. Does that sound right?
I think he's not the first reliever that they would be getting rid of. Because he had a good start, then he got hurt and he came back and he wasn't as good.
Yeah.
But you gotta like, he struck out, his strikeout rate was good. Like, there were a lot of like good signs, but yeah. I think he's probably on the safe side for now.
All right, moving right along. This guy I would have had a different answer on before I looked at his numbers earlier today, Jeffrey Springs.
Did he have one of like the highest strikeout rates?
He had a very good strikeout rate.
Yeah, for as a lefty, yeah, he did. It's weird because his overall numbers are... Yeah, I think him and Bryce Weber are all on that same tier.
You would put Bryce in that tier too? Okay.
Yeah, I think so. Because Springs is like, you need lefties at some point.
Right.
And they have, correct, obviously, they have Darwinzon, they have Josh Taylor, but they need some left-handed depth options. And I think if you compare Springs to the next guy, who I think is the other option, I probably would take Springs, I think.
No question. I think the next guy is the next guy out.
Probably. Yeah, he was bad last year. Wow. Yeah, so I think Springs is on the safer side for now, especially because he has three options has three options remaining too.
Matt Hall, Ian.
I think he's one of the first people gone.
I'm a little confounded with how he has made it this far, honestly.
Yeah, it's a fair point.
You know, I would rather have Domingo Tapia than Matt Hall.
I agree. I think Tapia just got caught in the numbers game if they have so many right-handed pitchers.
I
don't necessarily agree with it, but
he's a lefty.
I have not seen anything with Matt Hall that makes me confident that I would want him on my major league roster to open next season or even close to my major league
6.69 ERA.
Yeah. And it's not like Springs. Like, Springs had 28 strikeouts in 20 innings. I know his ERA was like 7. Matt Hall was like 9 strikeouts in 10 innings or whatever it was. You know, he gave up a ton of hard contact. He gave up 17 hits and 18 runs with 10 walks in 8 innings. Like, no thank you.
Yeah, I think Hall is in that initial tier.
Agree.
Next up, Alex Verdugo. He's a starting outfielder.
I would like to extend him too.
Yeah, I would not mind extending him. He's got one more year before ARB.
I guess you don't have to do it yet, but it would be interesting to see if he would take out, you know, like take like a 6-year deal or something, because he's someone I think is going to be a cornerstone for years to come.
I think that makes sense. Phillips Valdez pitched well. I think he's safe compared to a lot of these other guys.
Agree. He did slow down a little bit at the end of the year, but his peripherals are really good. His changeup was excellent. You know, he's a really nice find, and I think he's someone who can be a viable, you know, major league reliever. And I think, yeah, I think that he's probably on the safer side than a lot of the relievers we've talked about.
One guy who I kind of like, who I am also a little surprised has made it this far, is Robert Stock.
Yeah.
He struck a lot of guys out. I like the stuff. He also walked a lot of guys.
Yeah.
I mean it's kind of funny, actually. We had a typo on our site, and I thought he walked 19 in 13 innings, but it was he walked 10.
No one's that bad. Yeah,
I think he's in that next tier with you know, he's in the Hart Hall
tier. I agree. I think though that he's someone they would like to bring back in some capacity.
Yeah, and I mean, I also like him because he's a good Twitter follow, but nice, again, a nice pickup from Philly off waivers, but yeah, I just don't see it. Nick Pivetta, who knows what his role is? I think he gets
he'll be in the
opening day roster next year.
He'll be on the opening day roster. I think he probably starts in the rotation. What's he doing at the end of the year, I think, is a better question.
Fair. I mean, it'll depend on how he pitches, but I think he's probably – I think I would pencil him in as the number five starter right now heading into next season.
I would
be where I project him.
I would as well. Yairo Munoz.
I think he's – I mean, I would project him as the safest of the bench group of Arroyo, Chavis, and him. I think that he is the best bench fit there because he gives you the most position versatility. And, I mean, he was really good last year when he played.
Yeah. All right. All right. I dig it. Davy Grillon, I think, you know, third catcher, if they wind up needing the spot, they'd cut him loose. I don't think he's untouchable.
I don't think he's untouchable, but, like, he's a 25-year-old guy who, as you said, they have to have a third catcher on the 40-man, and they are going to add Connor Wong. But I think that he's pretty safe because you need someone. Well, you're not going to be comfortable going into the camp with Wong as your third catcher. And obviously, I know they're going to bring in like a Juan Centeno type, as they usually do.
Jack
but
Bandy type, yeah.
I think Rion has some upside. You know, he's pretty interesting. He can hit a little bit, it seems. You know, I like him in a third catcher role, and I don't think they would want to lose him for nothing.
I think he's in that Valdez tier of he's safe on this roster for now.
Yeah, a lot would have to change.
Yes.
A lot of turnover would have to happen for him to be in trouble.
Christian Arroyo, I also put in that tier.
I agree. I think they clearly like him a lot.
Yep.
And they were encouraged with what they saw with him. And I think we do forget, like, he was an elite prospect back in the day with the Giants. And, you know, he's had some injuries, he had some troubles, but he showed enough to me that I think he's on the safer side too.
So, and then the final player is Tanner Houck. We've talked plenty about him. He's obviously not getting outrighted. Like, he's
no. There's, you know, yeah, he's
we've
safe.
Got questions about him. It's fine. So then I guess let's look forward now. 5 days after the World Series is when free agency begins and the qualifying offers are due. The only guys I think Ian, that are going to get qualifying offers are JT Realmuto, Trevor Bauer, and George Springer. I think that might be it. I could maybe see DJ LeMahieu, but...
Wait, who did you say?
DJ LeMahieu.
No. What were the first... You said three, right?
Realmuto, Springer, and Bauer.
I agree.
I could see LeMahieu. I think it's less likely than it is likely.
I think he probably just ends up with the Yankees anyway, so I'm not
sure. Well, that's why I'm saying they're like, look, we'll offer you the QO. Let's continue working out a deal over the next 10 days. But
Stroman, can Stroman get it or no?
He can. I don't know that I would.
See, the one reason I think he might is if the Mets have Steve Cohen money, they could just... There's no downside for them. You know, I'd take Stroman on a 1 year, like $18 million deal.
19. It went up to 19.
If they're willing to spend, like it seems like they're telegraphing they are going to be, I don't know if they would, why they wouldn't want to slap the QO on him to at least have some control over that. But I agree that I think those three are the only locks.
No, Semien. I think he played his way out of one this year.
I agree. Ozuna would get one, but he can't. I don't think Didi Gregorius.
No. I mean, at that point, you're beyond the guys that are going to get a QO. Like, even a guy like a Liam Hendricks out of the bullpen, that's a lot of money.
I agree, especially for a reliever.
Yeah. So those are the days coming up. Ian, let's get to our emails. All right, our first email for this episode, Ian, comes from Greg. He says, hi, guys. Was the Red Sox biggest miss in the last year not trading Jackie Bradley Jr. to the Padres when they had the opportunity? From what I remember, they would have acquired Will Myers plus a prospect or two. Hindsight is 2020, but it seems like this would have been a steal. Thanks, as always, Greg. Ian, I think he's conflating two things. Am I remembering this right?
Yeah, I thought the trade was like they would basically trade a low-level prospect for Will Myers and like a prospect to dump Will Myers' salary.
Right. It wasn't trading Bradley. Like, they would have kept their major league team together.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, look, if they don't re-sign Bradley, like, you keep Bradley because you think you might want to re-sign him, and trading him would make that less likely.
Agree.
To like a one or two, maybe two-year deal.
Yeah, because like Bradley just didn't have a lot of value in the trade market either.
Right.
I don't
you're
think.
Not going to give him away for a bag of baseballs. Like, you're not going to give him away for like.
Especially because they didn't have anyone to play center field.
Right. Right. You need to feel the freaking team. Like.
Yeah.
And you know it. Yeah. So. Yeah.
But I mean, I think would they, in hindsight, would they probably have liked to do the Padres trade, especially since Will Myers became good again? Yeah, I'm sure they did, but I'm assuming that they didn't do it because the Padres weren't willing to give up what they considered, you know, a fair package to take on the Will Myers contract.
Right, right. I think that sounds right. Our next question comes from Patreon supporter Tim Harding. He says, love Mookie, happy for him, but this narrative that the Red Sox were cheap and how the trade was awful are annoying. He showed no interest in signing here long term, and he has never refuted that the $300 million offer didn't happen. He wanted to test free agency. Good for him. And then he changed his mind and signed. His right. I think Bloom got a nice haul under those circumstances. And then he goes on, he's got a question. But I would quibble with some of that, Ian. I don't know that it's on bets to refute anything. We don't really know what the numbers exchanged were.
No.
But I think he's right that he showed no interest in signing long term because he said he wanted to go to free agency. Like,
yeah, and I think I said it on Twitter a couple days ago that if Mookie Betts would have signed the deal he took with the Dodgers with the Red Sox, the Red Sox would have done that in a heartbeat. He wasn't interested in signing that deal at the time they traded him.
Yep.
That COVID deal was not an option. Man. COVID changed everything for him. He was going to go to free agency, even if he was on the Dodgers, if this was a normal year. It wasn't a normal year. He had to reevaluate, and I don't blame him one bit, given what we're seeing around baseball financially.
Prudent. Yeah, absolutely.
So at the end of the day, the timing sucked. Like, the Red Sox could have never projected that there was going to be a pandemic that would change the finances of baseball completely when they traded him.
Yeah.
But, you know, it sucks. But at some point, I think you just got to move on because there's no undoing what's done. Like, there's no point in rehab. And, like, my thing is, like, the people who every time Betts does something, like, make some comment about the Red Sox being cheap, it's just so stupid because the Red Sox, you can quibble with how the Red Sox went around negotiating with Betts. And I think they made some mistakes along the way. And I don't think they would dispute that. Like, I think the way they handled an arbitration was stupid. I think some of their offers probably were not smart. But at the end of the day, if Mookie Betts came to them and said, I will take 12 years, $360 million, they would have done that in a heartbeat. And I'm sure that offer was on the table if he wanted it. And he didn't want that deal. He wanted to go to free agency. And the Red Sox had a choice. They could either run out the final year of his contract and get nothing for him, or they could trade him and try to start rebuilding the team. And when you look at what the team was this year, if they have Mookie Betts, they're still not a good team. You know, this team is not making the playoffs even with Mookie Betts.
Like, guess what? If Mookie Betts were on this team and had not signed an extension yet, guess what everyone would be asking them to do at the trade deadline?
Trade him. The other thing is, too, if Mookie Betts...
For less.
Imagine what would happen if Mookie Betts just walked away in free agency from the Red Sox. They would be in no man's land. Think about this team. They wouldn't have Alex Verdugo, who was arguably their best player or second best hitter this year behind him and Bogaerts. They wouldn't have Jeter Downs. They wouldn't have Connor Wong. And, like, where would they be? They would just be...
2020 Washington Nationals.
Like, I don't...
2020 Washington Nationals. They lost Harper and Rendon for nothing.
Yeah, and I understand it's like flags fly forever, and if they were competitive this year, it's a different sort.
Completely, which the Nationals are the example because they won it last year. That makes it worth it.
But the Red Sox were clearly not going to be competitive this year, so I just, I don't get why, like... I just don't, it still baffles me, a lot of the takes on the Betts trade.
My question is regarding a Rafael Devers contract. If he signs one but has opt-outs, doesn't that, from a Red Sox perspective, defeat the purpose?
Yeah, you don't
great, thanks. I'm a little long-winded. Sorry. No, you're not, Tim. It's like the shortest email I read.
No, that was a great email. Yeah. You don't give Devers opt-outs. Like, the opt-outs, you do it with a free agent like Xander Bogaerts who you want to lock in. You don't do it with someone where you're doing them a favor in your eyes by buying out their arbitration years.
Well, and it's also, the opt-out is when you do a mega deal like a Giancarlo Stanton. They're not going to sign Devers for a 10-year, $400 million contract. You put in opt-outs because, like, may not be the worst thing in the world if this guy wants to opt out after year six.
Well, no, and the thing is, too, like, you're seeing when you're extending someone, you don't give opt-outs. Like, Ronald Acuna, Ozzie Albies, all these young studs who are signing these long-term deals, they're not getting opt-outs. Because if you're a team, you know you're getting them on a great contract. Why would you give them the option to get out of it?
Right, exactly. Our final email, Ian, comes from Mike. Mike says, hi, guys. I'm curious about your thoughts on this. Well, not exactly a hot take. I think it would be wise for the Red Sox to really try and re-sign Jackie Bradley Jr. at appropriate cost/years, as opposed to signing a 31-year-old George Springer who will cost them their second-round pick. I doubt they will have many more opportunities to pick this highly in future drafts, and there's obviously value there. Plus, there is potential that Duran is a real prospect, though. I am not sure that as his news swing... Okay. Plus, there is potential that Duran is a real prospect, though I'm not sure as his new swing hasn't been tested against other teams' pitching. I see a whole lot of similarities between this year and the offseason going into 2013 in terms of using this payroll flexibility to sign a bevy of middle market quality players in what is going to most likely be a depressed market. Just look at this insane Brad Hand situation. I see great potential for the recently reset Red Sox, say that three times fast, to really pounce on some of these opportunities. Thanks, guys. Mike. I mean, that's literally the point we're making.
Yeah, I completely agree.
On Bradley, I would love Bradley back on a 1 or 2 year deal. I think that would be, I think that's a great fit.
I think the best thing would be like a 1 year deal with a mutual option with like a, you know, $500,000 buyout or something. You know what I mean? Like a 1 year, $5 million deal with a $7 million mutual option.
I think I would like that because the thing is it protects you against Duran not panning out. It protects you against Benintendi.
Exactly.
Continuing to not be good.
But I think he's earned it for it to be like a mutual option, not a team or a player option, even not a team option. Like,
yeah, I like the mutual option idea. You know, player option, player could pick it up for X, team could pick it up for Y.
So I think something like that, if Bradley's willing to come back for us, I mean, the question is, we don't know what his demands are going to be, though, or his asks are going to be. Because he's earned the right. This is his first time in free agency. He's earned the right to go out and ask for the bag. But
yeah, I mean, let's see what he gets, though, in this market with his track record. I'm curious.
I'm fascinated by it. This free agent this offseason is going to be fascinating.
It's going to suck, but it's going to be fascinating.
As someone who's not involved, who's just watching from the outside, it's going to be very interesting. But if for the players involved and their agents, I don't think it's going to be very pleasant.
Oh, it's going to be a bit of a dark night of the soul to some degree. I mean, even just if you look at, we're going to get more labor strife nonsense.
That's the other thing, that big elephant in the room that we have not talked about at all, is that there's probably going to be a strike next year, or what is it, 2 years?
2 years
after next season.
Yeah.
Like, baseball needs to figure some stuff out, because between the minor league baseball situation, like next season, where they're going to obviously not have fans, and if the owners and try to pull this thing again and have a shortened season, because like it's not, they're going to lose so many fans if they try to do that again, things like that. It's not good, but that's all discussions for the spring when we know more.
The email is podcast@soxprospects.com. Send in your emails, thoughts, questions, concerns. We want to hear about, talk about what you want to hear about. And on that note, we're going to wrap it up. For Ian Kundle, I'm Chris Hatfield. Make sure you follow us on Twitter. Follow him at Ian Kundle. That's IAMCUNDALL. Follow me at SP Chris Hatfield. And make sure you follow him on the website at Sox Prospects. And I want to thank Podcast Joke 2.0 for keeping the show up and running. Thank you to the Ludlow Thieves for our intro / outro music. Find them on whatever service you use to listen to music or buy music, perhaps even a record store. Thank you all for listening. Thank you to our supporters on patreon.com/soxprospects. We will be back soon, approaching big number 200. Ian, getting close. We should plan something good for that one.
That would be fun.
All right, thank you all for listening, everyone. We'll be back in your eardrums soon.